It's my pleasure today to welcome an old friend, Heather Hirschfeld, who's a professor of English at the University of Tennessee-Knoxville and a esteemed scholar of Shakespeare and Renaissance drama, the author of two well-received monographs, Joint Enterprises and The End of Satisfaction, Drama and Repentance in the Age of Shakespeare, as well as the editor of the Oxford Handbook of Shakespearean Comedy, and what's going to be the subject of our discussion today, the new Cambridge Shakespeare Hamlet that just came out in 2019. Heather, what does it mean to a scholar such as yourself to be given the opportunity to edit Shakespeare, and in particular to edit Hamlet, perhaps the most famous text in English literature?
Yeah, that's a great question, Matthew. And I did feel that it was a great honor to be asked to do this by Cambridge University Press. Editing a Shakespeare play today is part of a long tradition, a centuries-old tradition of preparing his dramas for reading public. Since his fellows Hemings and Condell assembled the folio of Shakespeare's comedies, tragedies, and histories in 1623, students of his works have sorted through the surviving early published editions of his plays, and then they've made decisions about how to present them on the page and now the web page. I think that's a bit of what makes it different to do this work today. Our texts of Shakespeare come down to us from the 16th and 17th century print shop. Compared to our word processing and printing something out, the effort that went into printing a book at the time was enormous, really staggering amount of work. But there was no standardized spelling, there was no standardized punctuation, there were different conventions for letters, our U was a V and vice versa. And the difficulties in setting type led to errors, some that are easy to resolve and others that raise genuine interpretive problems, what we call today cruxes. One from Hamlet is he smote Pollux on the ice. Is that Pollux or Pollaxes? So modern day editors have to decide whether and how they want to accommodate these kinds of printing complexities. Do they modernize spelling? Do they correct errors, even if they aren't sure what a correct version would be, as in the case of Pollux on the ice? Do they supply punctuation where we have become accustomed to it? But that's just the tip of the iceberg. More significant issues arise because there are multiple early editions of several Shakespeare texts, including Hamlet. The first folio contains a total of 36 plays, half of which had been published in smaller, cheaper formats called quartos. For several of these plays, there are substantive variants between quarto versions and between quarto and the folio version. And that's where the pressure is really on the editor. Which of the versions should they choose as their copy text, the text they're going to make the substance of their version? If the different versions contain passages not in the other edition, should editors just stick to one copy text or should they combine them? A process called conflation. And on what basis should editors choose their copy texts? For a long time, the trend was to try to determine the relationship between the edition, the quarto or the folio, and Shakespeare's intentions. And I put that in quotation marks, his intentions for the play. The following is an overgeneralization, but there has been some agreement that in most situations, quartos represent something closer to Shakespeare's own manuscripts, none of which survive, while the folio represents something closer to what was performed on stage. For a good chunk of the 20th century, editors pursued an ideal Shakespeare text, what they imagined Shakespeare intended when he wrote a script and presented it to his acting company. But more recent editors have challenged the premise of this ideal or platonic Shakespeare, as well as our ability to determine Shakespeare's intentions. What if Shakespeare brought a text to his company expecting that they would cut it for performance or change the order of scenes? Why should Shakespeare's papers, rather than the company book of the play, what was closer to performance, govern the modern text? So Hamlet's textual situation is complex. There exist three distinct early versions of the play: the first quarto, which was published in 1603, the second quarto, which was published in 1604, 1605, and the text in the folio, which was published in 1623. There are differences between them, both large and small. Quarto two has over 200 lines not in folio, and folio has over 80 lines not in the quarto. And then Q1 is a text that's substantially different from both Q2 and folio, and the latter look a lot more alike in comparison to that first quarto. The first quarto is also has some particularly vivid stage directions that editors rely on. And then some other interesting differences is that to be or not to be comes much earlier. Polonius's name is Carambus. And Gertrude gets a lot more attention. She has her own scene with Horatio in Q1. Scholars do not necessarily agree on which kind of printer's copy should serve as copy text. Some champion the quartos because they derive from manuscripts closest to Shakespeare's own papers. Others champion texts that seem closest to the play as it was performed, and that's likely the folio. So just to let you know what the editor of the Cambridge edition did, Edwards relied on the folio edition of his copy text. And he argued, and here you have to pay a little attention to the paradoxes, that folio is closest to Shakespeare's intention. If this seems contrary to you, to the belief that the playwright's manuscript lies behind the quarto and is thus the more authorial, you are right. But Edwards argued that Shakespeare had made changes to the manuscript that informs the quarto. It was just that the printers didn't understand or follow them. So the changes are reflected in the folio, he maintains. So you can sort of get the sense of the gymnastics that editors have to do to make sense of what text to choose.
Review for us, when you accepted the job from Cambridge, what it is that they wanted you to do now that you're revising an already published earlier edition of Hamlet. What is it you were asked to do?
So Cambridge asked me to work on a revised edition of their new Cambridge Hamlet, and that was first published in 1985. And they wanted me to update it for the 21st century. So what they asked me to do was the introduction and then glosses, that is the commentary or footnotes at the bottom of the page that explain difficult terms and phrases and historical background that a student would need to know as they read the text itself. But they did not ask me to edit Hamlet. So all that discussion of that, the process of editing, was really left back to the original editor, Philip Edwards, and his 1985 version.
So Heather, you were explaining that you weren't able to go in and alter Edwards's play text, but that it seems like Cambridge gave you the opportunity to go in and engage with him in the glosses of the play text. Could you give us an example or two of how that played out for you?
Edwards was quite vehement in his interpretations. He used the commentary to advance his theory of the text and his interpretations of the text. And I felt strongly that the commentary should try to remain as neutral as possible. I recognize that pure objectivity is impossible, but that I didn't want to overdetermine students' own interpretations of the text. So I changed the commentary at regular intervals in order to follow that principle. And I can give you a couple of examples. One is from Act One, Scene Five, when Hamlet says, after the ghost has told him to remember him, Hamlet says, "Remember thee, I, thou poor ghost, whilst memory holds a seat in this distracted globe." And we need to gloss "this distracted globe." And Edward says, very with great force, "It is the world that Hamlet is talking about, not his head." And he goes on to talk about the fact that editors suggest he should put his hand upon his head, but the power and importance of this sentence is that it refers to a disordered world and preludes Hamlet's conviction that he is called upon not to right a personal wrong, but to repair a distracted world. Hamlet turns to himself, to my memory. For his part, he will erase all inessential and misleading memory and preserve only what is truly valuable. It only dilutes the strength of this passage to find a triple pun here, world, head, and theater. And on the contrary, I find it enlarges our experience of the play to engage those meanings. So my gloss was, it is tempting to see this as a triple pun on three possible meanings: the troubled world of Denmark, Hamlet's troubled head or mind, and the Globe Theater. And I'll leave it to readers, audiences to figure that out, which direction they wanted to take it in. And in a similar way, another example of the strong readings that Edwards gives in his glosses that I wanted to correct has to do with Gertrude. He was sort of uniformly antagonistic to Gertrude, and you can hear it in this gloss from a line in 1-3 when Laertes is talking to Ophelia about Hamlet and how she can't have him as her boyfriend. He says to her, "For on his choice depends the sanctity and health of this whole state." Edwards glosses sanctity, which is a folio reading, and says that sanctity fits admirably the rather fervent and excessive way in which Laertes speaks of everything. More than that, it illustrates how everyone in the play contributes in his or her own marked manner of speaking to the central meanings of the play. The health of the kingdom is a spiritual health, and it is indeed true, though Laertes cannot know it, that the present spiritual sickness of the kingdom arises from Gertrude's infidelity to the king. And he's offering this in 1-3. We don't know very much yet, and we certainly shouldn't decide already that Gertrude has been unfaithful. So I glossed it to say that sanctity fits the rather fervent and excessive way in which Laertes speaks of everything, and it underscores the play's broader concern with the spiritual health of the kingdom after the death of Hamlet Sr. and the remarriage of Gertrude to Claudius. So those are a couple of the glosses, and you can imagine that this was a full-time job trying to address the, his rather vehement readings.
What I want to do is just show this brief clip of from Branagh's Hamlet, where he does the to be or not to be. In Kevin Branagh's production of Hamlet, he makes interpretive decisions that are available to him because of the absence of stage directions, and that this is something that Shakespeare is notorious for, and that is generally having a scarcity of stage directions, that even though the camera work suggests perhaps that Hamlet is aware that he's being overheard, that he's conforming to the tradition that when you deliver that speech, to be or not to be, Hamlet believes himself to be alone and thus is sharing with the audience these sort of deep, honest truths about where he is in life, and not that this is designed to, as part of the game that he's playing with Claudius, as to the revenge plot that's at the center of the play. And I was wondering, as somebody who's tackled these editorial issues, what your thoughts were about these kinds of textual cruxes.
Well, this is probably the biggest one. And it's both a textual crux, because the speech looks different in the three different versions, the quarto, quarto one, quarto two, and the folio, but also because of the stage conventions around the soliloquy. And as you were saying, the lack of specific stage directions that may in fact be a function of conventionalized stage activity. So I love the Branagh version, but I love it in many ways because it's not how I imagine it in my mind's eye. And I was recently the dramaturg for a production at the University of Tennessee for our Actors Equity Theater here, the Clarence Brown Theater, where they played it very much as though Hamlet thought he was alone and was voicing his own thoughts to himself. I think I'm of the school that Hamlet is voicing his thoughts, that these are meant to be spoken out loud. It's not an interior monologue being represented, but that he is speaking aloud and that he's participating in a convention of the soliloquy that's meant to, and you mentioned it yourself, to include the present theater audience. So that even though these are his own thoughts directed to himself, there's an element of delivering it for somebody to get a kind of outsider's ear, that he's speaking these things for an audience, just not the audience of Claudius and Polonius. I really like some recent work by Brian Cummings, who talks about this, and this is a traditional understanding of the soliloquy as a kind of prayer, and that Hamlet's in conversation with himself, he's his own audience, or he's in conversation with God, and that's another audience. So I may be sort of trying to find a middle way between the heightened performativity that you get in the Branagh version, where it really does seem, whether it was intentional or not, that he's threatening Polonius and Claudius, telling him that he knows that he's out to catch their consciences, and something very internal. And my take is very much based in how I imagine it as a stage convention in the late 16th century, early 17th century.
It seems like your hands were tied when it came to making changes, significant changes in the play text itself that Cambridge was publishing, but that they gave you this wonderful opportunity with the introduction to make an intervention of your own as to how you wanted to frame Hamlet, what issues and what interpretations about Hamlet you wanted to bring to the foreground. What were some of the things that you did to take advantage of that opportunity that you're proud of?
First, I would say that as much as my hands were tied, I think I felt fortunate that my hands were tied by sticking to that text, that it, having to redo the text, as I suggested, would have been a huge undertaking. So there were moments when I was truly thankful that I was not being asked to make some of those editorial decisions. But I am delighted with the way I was allowed to reframe the introduction more thematically, which I think is what interests students today. It was an exercise in thinking both in scholarly fashion and in a more pedagogical fashion. How do we excite students about this hugely canonical play that comes with its own weight in ways that students sometimes find overwhelming? I started with a kind of theme of the stranger, especially in the time period that I was working on this, when there were a lot of questions about who counts as a stranger and who counts as an alien. I thought it was really important to emphasize the way in which Hamlet, again, the center of our Western canon, is actually very much a stranger, an outsider in Elsinore, and stranger and outsider to himself and his family. So I organized the introduction around the strangeness Hamlet is feeling in the aftermath of the death of his father and the remarriage of his mother. I emphasized the strangeness of the text, its textual situation, and the kind of strange encounters within the text itself. The ghost is one obvious place of strangeness and the uncanny, but also in the kinds of doublings and foiling in the play, with Laertes as a foil for Hamlet, with Ophelia in some ways as she goes truly mad as a foil for Hamlet. So I wanted, that was a big frame. And then within that larger frame, I was particularly interested in the issue of revenge. And I put that front and center as well.
Thanks so much, Heather, for sharing your insights. We really appreciate it here at the University of Louisville, and I'll be delighted to share with my students, and I hope one day after COVID to welcome you again to Louisville.
Thank you so much. Thanks for giving me this platform to talk about Hamlet and related editorial questions. I will love to visit you again in Louisville, and hope you'll get a chance to come to Knoxville as well.